Hello and welcome to this lecture in the course for Secure Systems Engineering. In the previous lecture, we had actually looked at an introduction to fault injection attacks, and we had seen a very simple fault injection attack on the RSA public key cipher. In this video, we would look at fault injection attacks on a popular block cipher known as AES. The assumption here is that the viewers are know about the AES algorithm and the various operations that are involved with an AES encryption. So let us look at how a fault attack on a block cipher actually works. We assume that the attacker has a device which is doing an encryption, like an AES encryption. And in order to do this particular encryption, the device has a key which is stored inside the device. Now, the objective for the attacker is to extract this secret key from the device. In order to do this, the attacker would inject false as the cipher is actually doing an encryption or a decryption. It is also assumed that the attacker is able to control what plain text gets encrypted and is also able to view the corresponding ciphertext. The basic attack, as we have seen in the previous video, is as following. Attacker chooses a random plain text, passes it to the device, and forces the device to perform an encryption. The device would then pick the secret key which is stored inside the device, perform an encryption on the plain text using that particular secret key, and obtain a ciphertext. We call the ciphertext as the fault-free ciphertext. Now, the attacker would use the same plain text and pass it to the device and force the device to do an encryption on that plain text. The device would encrypt that plain text using the same stored secret key and the plain text. And during this encryption process, the attacker now injects a fault. Now, the fault is injected and it would disturb the encryption process, resulting in a faulty ciphertext. The attacker then uses a fault-free ciphertext and the faulty ciphertext to obtain some information about the secret key. So what happens when you actually inject a fault is that some computation during the process of encryption gets disturbed. Now, if we actually think that a fault is injected, say at this particular location in a block, in this particular block cipher, this fault modifies the output of this particular operation. The error due to the fault then propagates to the remaining parts of the cipher. So these red lines over here show how the fault propagates through the cipher structure and eventually affects all the bits of the ciphertext. Thus, the attacker has two ciphertext, the fault-free ciphertext and the faulty ciphertext. So the faulty ciphertext is denoted as C star, and the fault-free ciphertext is denoted by C. Now, the differences between these two are then used by the attacker to gain secret information. Let's take a very simple fault attack on the AES block cipher. So, as we, as many of you would know, the AES is probably the most famous or most commonly used block cipher these days. The AES takes 128-bit plain text as input, which we label here as P, and each bit is labeled P0, P1 to P127. It does various operations on this particular plain text. These operations not only depend on the input, but also on the secret key or the AES secret key. And eventually, after 10 rounds, what we obtain is the ciphertext C, which comprises of bits C0 to C127. Now, in order to demonstrate the simple attack on AES, what an attacker needs to do is to inject a fault in exactly the last round of AES. So, the attacker need not know what is happening during the entire AES, but important for him is the last operation, what is performed on the AES. The last operation is as follows. It has a key. This is known as the 10th round key. And this 10th round key is XORed with some intermediate state obtained from this during the encryption process to give you the ciphertext. So, thus what we will see in this attack is the attacker would be able to get one bit of this ciphertext by injecting a fault. Now, the fault the attacker would inject is targeted to this specific location, and the fault is very specific. This type of fault would force this particular line to be zero. So, this is known as a stuck at a zero fault, and this is a very popular fault model, especially from the VLSI testing perspective. So, independent of what value was present, whether it is 0 or 1 or so on, this fault would force this line to 0. As a result, what we would see in the output is this value C hash 0 would always have the value of K naught. So, therefore, what we see is that the secret key bit K naught is then passed to the output. So, the attacker would just need to look at this significant bit of the ciphertext to determine what the value of K naught is. So, in this way, the attacker has obtained one bit of the secret key. In a similar approach, by injecting faults in all other bits, the attacker would be able to obtain all the bits of the secret key. Now, the problem with this attack, though it's extremely simple, is the fact that we would require 128 bits to completely recover the entire AES secret key. Now, first of all, creating this bit fault is extremely difficult, and furthermore, we would require 128 such bit faults to completely extract the secret key of AES. So, in the past, people have actually studied this problem, and they have tried to find out solutions by which, firstly, we can reduce the number of faults that are required to obtain the secret key of the cipher, and second, also relax the fault model. Instead of having a bit fault, the researchers have tried to find out whether other kinds of faults, such as random faults in bytes or multiple byte faults, can be exploited to obtain the secret key. So, let us see an attack which is slightly better than this one. What we will show next is that the attacker can reduce the number of faults required from 128 to 16 by just changing the location of where the fault is injected. The central idea for this is to look at this structure. This structure comprises of some input which we denote P. P is not necessarily the plain text, but it could be some intermediate state of the cipher. This gets XORed with the key, and then there is an SBOX operation, and then you have a ciphertext output. Now, if the attacker is able to inject a fault at this location on P and chain the value of P to P plus E, where E is the fault that is injected, now the output obtained would be erroneous. So, in fact, with this, the attacker can get two equations. One is the fault free equation. Let us consider this output as C, and this output due to the fault getting induced at this point to be C star. What we definitely knew is that since the fault is induced, C will definitely not be equal to C star. So, we can write, we can represent this in an equation form as follows: C is equal to S of P XOR K. Similarly, this would be equal to C star would be equal to S P XOR E XOR K. Note that since E has a value which is not equal to 0, therefore, we have an SBOX operation based on this, which would look completely different. So, now let us look at what C XOR C star is, and what we see is that we can represent this as S of P XOR K XOR with S of P XOR E XOR K. Since the attacker knows the faulty ciphertext and the fault-free ciphertext, this particular component of the equation is known. Now, also what the attacker could then do is iterate through all possible values of K and identify which of these equations are actually satisfied. So, let us say that E has is a single bit fault, and therefore E could have a value either 0001, because it is in this case modifying the LSB bit, or it could have values like 0000 0010, and so on to up to 1 1 2 3 1 2 3 4. Thus there are 8 possible values for E. Now, for each of these possible values of E, one can identify what is the solution for this equation and validate whether it is matching the LHS. So, since this S box or the S function has 256 different values for AES, the number of solutions for this particular equation reduces down to just 8. In other words, what the attacker would require would end up with over here is just 8 different values for this key K. Thus, the attacker has reduced the key space for this from 256 different values of K to just 8 different values for K. So, let us see how this can be done in practice. Now, if we consider the last round of AES, there are 3 operations. One is a substitute byte followed by the shift row and then a mix column. Now, if the attacker injects a fault at this particular location, it would disturb exactly this byte. Now, this byte would actually be modified due to the substitute byte operation, and substitute byte is essentially represented as S of P. So, as a result of the fault, the output of this substitute byte is S of P when there is no fault, and S of P plus F when a fault is injected. As this passes through and finally reaches the output, this particular byte of the output is either S of P plus XOR or S of P plus F plus K. So, based on this, the attacker can build this equation, C0 plus C0 star, where C0 star is the faulty ciphertext byte, C0 is the correct ciphertext byte, or as we call it, the fault free ciphertext byte. And for each of the different values of the fault F, the attacker would be able to iterate through all possible values that satisfy this equation. And then as the AES S box is well known, we would then be able to identify 8 values for P, and therefore we would obtain 8 different candidate values for the secret key K. So, there have been a lot more different attacks for the AES block cipher. In fact, the attacks have further reduced the number of faults injected from 16 faults, as we have seen over here, to just a single fault. In fact, the best known attack on AES just requires a single fault present in the 8th round, which can completely obtain the AES secret key. So, we will not go into details about these fault attacks, but we will actually stop over here and leave it to the interested viewers to actually go through the relevant papers to look at the other more powerful fault attacks on AES. Thank you.